Thank you. So, yesterday we encountered the crossing symmetry equation. So that's crossing symmetry for a sphere four-point function. It's an equation for the spectrum of the CFT S and for the three-point structure constant C. And if you know this data, basically you have solved your Kampfmann field theory. By saying it's an equation for S and C, I'm assuming I know these objects, the conformal blocks. So these objects are, in practice, not very simple, but they are known in principle because they are completely determined by symmetry. So now how do we solve this equation? So this is a quadratic equation for the structure constants, and it's quite non-trivial. Typically, the sums on both sides can be infinite. And therefore, the equation can be rather difficult to solve. So it's things become simpler if, by some for some reason, the sums here become finite. And now we will study a case when the sum become finite. It's the case of a four-point function with a degenerate field at level 2, V21 of Z. So this four-point function obeys Belyavin, Polyakov, Zamochikov differential equation of order 2, which is rewritten here. So this equation is a consequence of Ward identities plus the presence of a null vector which vanishes in the for this primary field. And so this equation really applies not only to the four-point function, but also to the conformal blocks which are involved in the decomposition of this four-point function. So conformal blocks should obey all linear symmetry equations that are obeyed by the corresponding correlation functions, so in particular Ward identities and the BPC equation. So conformal blocks actually will provide us a basis for this a basis of solutions of this equation. And since it's an equation of order 2, the basis will have just two elements. So now let's find out more precisely what these two elements are. So by definition, S-channel conformal blocks behave in a specified way when Z goes to 0. So the S-channel conformal block with dimension delta is Z to the delta minus minus delta 1 minus delta 2 times some power series in Z. So we should look for solutions of this equation that are of this type. And it turns out that there exist just two such solutions with very specific values of the dimension delta. So the specific values that are allowed are correspond to the momentums P equals P1 plus or minus B over 2. So the corresponding exponents here are called the characteristic exponents of this differential equation at z equals 0. So let me write them as delta of p1 plus or minus p over 2. Ah, sorry, so here I'm mixing up the notations. I mean, now I'm considering here delta 2, 1. So I'm really in this situation where I have 2, 1 here, delta 1, delta 2, delta 3. And here, well, let's write it in terms of the momentum, rather. P1, P2, P3. And here I have P1 plus or minus B over 2. So that solution will be called F plus or minus of Z. So to come back to this definition of a characteristic exponent, so the corresponding exponents here, so delta of p plus or minus b over 2 minus delta 1 minus delta 2 1 are called a characteristic exponent of the BPZ equation, of this particular differential equation. Okay, so we have these two solutions, and well, what are these solutions? Well, maybe some of you have recognized this as a well-known differential equation. I mean, it's called the hypergeometric differential equation, and therefore the solutions are hypergeometric functions. So the corresponding conformal blocks will be called, if you want, hypergeometric conformal blocks. And the formula is as follows. So Fs epsilon. Epsilon is plus or minus here. Is z to the b q over 2 minus epsilon p1, 1 minus z b q over 2 plus p3. F, so this f is the hypergeometric function. It can also be denoted 2f1 of 1 half plus b minus epsilon p1 plus p2 plus p3. So it has three parameters and one argument. So the three parameters are this expression, this expression, minus epsilon p1 minus p2 plus p3. The third parameter is 1 minus 2b epsilon p1. And the argument is z. Yes?
So this plus minus sign that you have, is really because there are two solutions, or is it because you have 2, 1, and 1, 2 as a choice?
So your question is where does this plus minus come from? And indeed, it comes from the existence of two solutions. Epsilon equals plus minus is a label for the two solutions. I have always this field 2, 1. I'm not considering the field 1, 2 for the moment. And I have two solutions because that's a second order differential equation. Yeah. Which is because our null vector was at level 2, if you remember. So these are the two S-channel conformal blocks that can appear in the decomposition of this particular four-point function. Now, if we want to use crossing symmetry, we'd better look at what happens in the T-channel. And in the T-channel, well, it's the same situation. We still have the same differential equation, but we will be looking for a different basis of solutions. Because the conformal blocks in the T-channel are supposed to behave as follows. Now they are singular, they have a regular singularity at z equals 1, with an exponent delta minus delta 3 minus delta 2, 1. So the diagram for the T-channel block is the following, 2, 1, p3, p1, p2. And here, the possible momentums in the T-channel are p3 plus or minus b over 2. And therefore, therefore we have two T-channel conformal blocks, if you want, f eta t of z, well, which I'm not writing explicitly, but they are also hypergeometric functions. So now we know that our four-point function is a linear combination of such blocks. So in general, since we have left-moving and right-moving blocks, the linear combination could involve actually four terms, something like sum of over, let's say, epsilon, epsilon bar. Both of them are signs of some coefficient, C epsilon, epsilon bar, F epsilon of Z, F epsilon bar of Z bar. So that would be the most general solution of the left-moving and right-moving BPZ equations. However, we don't just want any solutions. We want solutions that are in particular single-valued. So let's look for single-valued solutions. Well, here it's a bit more restrictive. I mean, we know how the S-channel block behaves near z equals zero. It has this singularity. And to get a single-valued solution, well, in general, what you have to do is to take the same block on the left and on the right in order to have the same exponent. So the more reasonable on that is a sum over just one sign, epsilon, of some coefficient C epsilon. Well, let me call it C epsilon S for S channel. F epsilon S of Z, F epsilon S of Z bar. So this combination is good because it has no monodromy around Z equals one, Z equals zero. So, but we also should have no monodromy around z equals 1. And to write a solution that has no monodromy around z equals 1, the simplest thing to do is to start with t-channel blocks, because these t-channel blocks have very well-defined monodromy around z equals 1. So let's combine t-channel blocks in the same way by writing sum eta equals plus minus, sum c eta t, f eta t of z, f eta t of Z bar. So this one has no monodromy. Around Z equals one. Now these two expressions should actually coincide. That's crossing symmetry. So, but other questions? So if there are no questions, let's see what it implies that these two formulas are the same. Well, the S-channel and T-channel blocks are two bases of solutions of the same equation. So two bases of the same two-dimensional space of solutions. So therefore, they should be related. And the relation, well, looks like this. F epsilon S of Z equals the sum over eta F. So it's a square F now. F epsilon eta, F t eta of z. So this square F is a matrix called, if you want, the fusing matrix. That's just the matrix of this change of basis for conformal blocks. Now we could plug this change of basis into this expression in terms of S-channel blocks, and we would get some expression now in terms of T-channel blocks. Maybe let's do it. So T of Z equals sum epsilon equals plus minus C epsilon S sum eta equals plus minus, but I also need an eta prime. Well, let's say an eta bar, and we have F epsilon eta, F epsilon eta bar, Ft eta of z, Ft eta bar of z bar. So we have an alternative expression for the same four-point function in terms of t-channel conformal blocks. But of course, this expression should coincide with this expression, and the coefficient of any of these blocks should be the same, which gives us an equation of, which gives us relations between these quantities, the coefficients C epsilon S and C eta T. So it does not just give us the relation between the S-channel and T-channel coefficients, but it gives us even a relation among the S-channel coefficients. Because if I'm taking, if I take a non-diagonal combination like Ft plus of Z, Ft minus of Z bar, well, this combination does not appear here because it has a non-trivial monodromy around Z equals one. So the coefficient of this combination of blocks must be zero. And writing that it has zero coefficient will give us the relation between Cs plus and Cs minus. And the relation in terms of this fusing matrix looks like F minus plus F minus minus over F plus minus F plus plus. So of course the hypergeometric conformal blocks are known explicitly, and the fusing matrix here is also known explicitly. I will not write it now. I will just write this particular combination when I need it, but this will be later, tomorrow probably. So for the moment, let's just take this conclusion that we can determine the ratio of these coefficients, and therefore we can determine actually this single-valued four-point function up to just an overall factor. That ratio, yeah. So it's just a function of the momentums, the p. Right. By definition, this fusing matrix does not depend on z. So this is a function of, if you want, pi and b. This fusing matrix. Yes.
Can't there be special momenta for which it's still single-valued, even if the epsilon is not different?
Yeah, so your question is whether for specific values of the momentums, maybe it could be single-valued. I mean, I could have extra single-valued solutions, which I may not have written. And right, I mean, it could happen, because here I'm taking a diagonal combination with essentially the same the same as channel dimensions on the left and on the right, but actually to have single valuedness, it's enough that the dimensions differ by integers. So I could have for very special values of momentums, I mean, this could happen, you're right. Here I'm taking generic momentums. Yes? Well, for the moment, we didn't fix it. We will fix it later when, in the context of Liouville theory. So the question was, how do we fix the overall constant now that we have determined this four-point function up to an overall constant? Actually, we are, if you want, halfway through the bootstrap, because we wrote these coefficients, but we did not yet express these coefficients in terms of our three-point structure constants. And that's what we need to do in order to fix the overall constant. Okay, so for the moment, let's say this was to illustrate in a more concrete example what this crossing symmetry equation and what the conformal blocks are. And now we will leave four-point functions for some time and focus on more algebraic properties of these degenerate representations, because that's what we need to do minimal models. So these algebraic properties I want to mention are visible here. We noticed that what could appear in the S-channel was just two values of the conformal dimension or momentum, the two values P1 plus or minus B over 2. So let me give an algebraic interpretation of this remark. So the interpretation is that I'm starting with a representation, a degenerate representation R21. So the field V21 belongs to this representation. And I'm taking some Verma module V VP, well, I was taking VP1. Let me write it VP now. And by taking the operator product expansion between fields in this representation and in this representation, what I get are fields that should belong to VP plus or minus B over 2. So let me define an operation that takes this representation and gives us the formal linear combination of these two representations. And that I will call the fusion product. So at the moment, this fusion product is just a way to write the constraints on operator product expansions that come from a symmetry, including the presence of null vectors. So it's, let's say, a formulation of constraints on operator product expansion from symmetry. Well, actually, it's possible to give an algebraic definition of the fusion product as some kind of generalization of the tensor product. But we don't really need this definition. What we need is rather the property. So since we don't have a definition, let's take this property as an axiom. So the fusion product is associative. Well, so in other words, A fusion B fusion C equals A fusion B fusion C. So which fusion products do we already know? Well, we know the fusion product of this degenerate representation at level 2 with the Verma module. We certainly know also for the other degenerate representation at level 2, R12, with the Verma module. So that would give us sum plus minus V P plus minus 1 over 2B. And we know how the level 1 degenerate representation fuses. That's just VP. So why do I say that we know it? Well, apart from having seen it in this operator product expansion here, we have equivalently seen it also in three-point functions. So if you remember, when I had this three-point function V11, VP2, VP3, for this to be non-zero, I needed P2 equals P3. And now this fusion product is an interpretation, if you want, of this fact. So other questions on this? Okay, so if there are no questions, let's use the associativity then to explore a bit more this fusion product. So let's start with let's say we want to determine the fusion product of R21 with R21. So to do that, I want to use associativity. I want to take a fusion product with some Verma module. So first I can compute this because I know how to compute this, and then I will know how to compute that. And the answer is just VP minus B plus 2 times VP plus VP plus B. So on the other hand, let's try to consider it this way. So this way, well, I don't really know the fusion product of these two degenerate representations, but I know some things already. Because this degenerate representation is just the coset of a Verma module by some module. And so it has to obey the same word identities, the same constraints, as if I was taking the fusion product with the corresponding Verma module, VP21. So we know this particular fusion product, that would be VP21 minus B over 2 plus VP21 plus B over 2. In other words, well, let me remind you that PRS is 1 half BR plus B minus 1 S. So this thing is nothing but VP11 plus VP31. And now, we are not really getting Verma modules when we do these fusion products of two degenerate representations, because we know that if we do this further fusion product with a Verma module, we get just finitely many terms, so we get constraints that we wouldn't get from Verma modules. Actually, what we must get are degenerate representations. And which degenerate representations? Well, this Verma module, we already know, corresponds to a degenerate representation R11. And this Verma module, well, we can guess that it corresponds to some degenerate representation R31. And for this to be compatible with associativity, I need, in addition to the fusion rule of R11, which I already know, I need the fusion rule of R31 to be VP minus B plus VP plus VP plus B. Yeah, the question is to go slower. So let's go slower. Well, let's start with the result. And first, I'll try to show the result is consistent. So let's assume that this R21 times R21 is R11 plus R31. Is this compatible with this result? Well, if I assume this, then when computing this fusion product, I need to do R11 plus R31 times VP. So R11 times VP is already known. That would just be VP. And R31 times VP is what I just guessed here. Well, I guessed it just in order to get the right result here, actually. Because if I'm adding this with VP, here I'm getting this combination with two copies of VP. So the results really are that we have determined the fusion product of R21 with itself to be this combination. And we have also guessed or determined the existence of a degenerate representation R31 with the momentum P31. And we have also determined that this degenerate representation has this fusion product with Verma modules. Yes?
So here you're assuming still that the central charge is general, because for special central charges,
yeah, the yeah, good point. So the question is whether the central charge is general, and indeed I'm having here a general central charge. So I don't have extra null vectors messing around. Although this could still be true if I had extra null vectors, but I didn't set them to zero. Okay. So essentially what I've done here is to redefine the notion of degenerate representation. So let's call it a redefinition. A degenerate representation. So instead of having of being defined by having a null vector, is a representation. Is a representation whose fusion product with Verma modules is a finite sum of Verma modules. So we could check that this new definition agrees with the previous definition by looking at a Verma module with the dimension with the momentum P31. And if you look at level 3 in this Fermat module, you will find a null vector. And if you look at the constraints from this null vector, you should be able to rederive this fusion product here. However, the calculations would be more complicated than what we did using just associativity. And actually, using this associativity of fusion, we can recover all the degenerate representations. So that's an exercise to... So find degenerate representations, RRS, for any R and S strictly positive integers, and find the fusion rules of these degenerate representations. So let me write the result. So the result should be that RRS times the Verma module is a sum from I equals minus R minus 1 over 2 to R minus 1 over 2, sum S J equals minus S minus 1 over 2 to S minus 1 over 2 of VP plus IB plus JB minus 1. And the fusion of R1 S1 with R2 S2 should give a sum for R equals R1 minus R2 plus 1 to R1 plus R2 minus 1, S equals S1 minus S2 plus 1 to S1 plus S2 minus 1 of R, RS. Yeah, so the question is...
Here you have constructed this degenerate representation that you knew, but how can I see that there isn't something else?
Yeah, so the question is whether these definitions are really equivalent, basically, the definition between having finite sum and having null vectors. And, well, basically, they are equivalent because I'm in a very simple case of just a Virasoro symmetry algebra. But if you have a larger symmetry algebra, you can have like semi-degenerate representations with, and to have a degenerate representation in this sense with finite sums, you need basically as many null vectors as you can have. So that could be called a fully degenerate representation. Here, well, we are just in this simple case of the Virasoro algebra. So in this case, it is equivalent. Yes? Ah, yes, thank you for the clarification. So here the sum is not over all integers from this one to this one, but it's modulo 2. So I jump by 2 each time I increment this R. Yes? So the question is, why does this look suspiciously like a tensor product of representations of SU2, and whether this is a coincidence? No, so basically, it's not a coincidence, but it looks like indeed a tensor product of integral spin, half integral spin representations of SU2. Essentially, it's as if I had two independent representations of SU2, one for the left index, the index R, and one for the right index, the index S. So at this level, for generic central charge, indeed it's the same. When we specialize to rational central charges, it will become different. So now that we know degenerate representations, we can really start to study minimal models. So that's the fourth section. So far we have done conformal field theory in the generic situation, but now we will start studying specific models, so looking for specific solutions of this crossing symmetry and other equations. So we'll start with minimal models because, well, they are relatively simple, and they are simple by definition. So a minimal model is a conformal field theory whose space of states is a direct sum of finitely many irreducible representations of my symmetry algebra, which is the product of left moving Virasoro and right moving Virasoro. Okay, so how do we build minimal models? Well, we start by making our life simpler by focusing on diagonal minimal models. So we want the spectrum to be a sum over some representations R of R times R bar. So here by R bar, I mean some representation of Virasoro bar, and it is the same representation as R, but R is a representation of the left moving Virasoro, so I put a bar just to say that it's for the right moving Virasoro. So which representations should we take? Well, we have just spent some time studying the degenerate representations, so it looks like a good idea to use them. Well, I could probably not prove that you can't build minimal models without degenerate representations. So let's have it as an axiom. The spectrum is made of degenerate representations. And we have also spent some time looking at the fusion product. So let's take this as an axiom as well, that the spectrum is stable under fusion, meaning if I have two representations which appear here, then anything that appears in their fusion product should also appear. Well, which is not completely obvious because, the fusion tells you that it can appear in some operator product expansion, but now I'm saying that everything that can appear does appear with a non-zero coefficient. This axiom is a bit restrictive. I mean, it's not true in E-series minimal model, but we'll focus on the A and D series, so in cases where it works. So let's start with...
Yes.
Yes, there is a specific E-series minimal model. I'm not sure which one, but the question was in which model doesn't this axiom hold? But yeah. So let's assume that we have a representation R21 in our spectrum, for example. So that's the simplest non-trivial degenerate representation. And let's start to do fusion products. Well, certainly we have to include R11 and R31. Okay, but now we can do further fusion products. And actually, if you have R21 and you fuse it with RS, well, what you get is R-1S, R plus 1S. So by doing repeated fusions, it looks like I will get at least all the representations are R1 for any R equals 1, 2, etc. And if I'm adding in the mix the representation R1, 2, by repeated fusion, So let me write it like that. I start with R2-1 and R1-2. I do fusion, and I'm ending up with all the RRS for any RS integer. But, well, basically, that's how we obtain these representations, RRS. So that's maybe not a good way to build a minimal model, since we want a finite number of representations. So we have to make further restrictions. Before making these restrictions, maybe we could still pause for a moment and think that if the answer is not what we want, maybe the question was not the right question. Maybe we could be happy with a model with infinitely many degenerate representations. So let's write a spectrum of the type direct sum of all these degenerate representations. Well, the same on the left and on the right. Well, that's closed under fusion. That looks nice enough. So let's call this the spectrum of the generalized minimal model. So what is a generalized minimal model? Well, by definition, it's a CFT with the spectrum let me call it SGMM now. Well, assuming it exists and is unique, of course. And this would be true for essentially any value of the central charge. So if I'm talking about it, it's because actually it exists and is unique. Well, except possibly for some rational values of the central charge. I mean, this question has not really been investigated in detail. But at least for generic non-rational values, I mean, it exists, as we will be able to prove later by studying crossing symmetry. Okay, so that was, if you want, a side remark. But maybe we should go back to our initial aim to find minimal models. So, other questions? So what do we do to avoid this proliferation of degenerate representations? Well, the trick is to take doubly degenerate representations with two different null vectors, so as to have more constraints in the fusion products. So for example, let's assume for a moment that the dimensions delta 2-1 and delta 1-3 coincide. So let me take this as an assumption. In this case, let's have a degenerate representation, R2-1. Well, I'm writing R2-1 equals R1-3. What I really want is a degenerate representation which has these two null vectors and where these two null vectors are set to zero, both of them. Therefore, this representation has to obey the fusion rules of R2-1, but also, at the same time, the fusion rules of R1-3. Now, if we fuse it with itself, we get R2-1 times R2-1 equals, well, as before, R1-1 plus R3-1. But also, we get R1-3 times R1-3 equals R1-1 plus R1-3 plus R1-5. And if you remember, the fusion rules really are the formalization of constraints from the presence of null vectors. So if I have two null vectors, I have to obey all the constraints. So I can't have R1-1 because it obeys both constraints, if you want, but the rest should be eliminated because it appears only here or only there. And therefore, for such a doubly degenerate representation, the fusion rules become simplified. So I just get one term on the one possible representation on the right-hand side. So this is encouraging that doubly degenerate representations might be used to build minimal models. Now, the only problem is that I have assumed a coincidence of these representations. I have assumed a representation with two null vectors. Each null vector gives me a constraint on the conformal dimension. And if I have these two constraints, well, I will end up actually with a constraint on the central charge itself, because these degenerate dimensions are functions of the central charge. So in general, if I have a constraint of the type delta RS equals delta R prime S prime, this is equivalent to PRS equals plus or minus P R prime S prime. And if you remember that PRS is half RB plus SB minus 1, you deduce that B squared must be rational. Let me write it as minus Q over P with PQ non-zero coprime integers. And the corresponding central charges, let me call them CPQ. They are just 1 minus 6 P minus Q squared over PQ. By the relation between C and B, I mean, let me remind you that it is C equals 1 plus 6 Q squared, and Q is B plus 1 over B. So, any questions? Yeah, so then let's focus on such a rational value of B squared in order to have the existence of degenerate representations, and doubly degenerate representations. And for a given value of B squared of this type, let's look at all the possible coincidences between degenerate conformal dimensions. Maybe I can just do it here. Well, it turns out that the coincidences of conformal dimensions are of degenerate dimensions are essentially reduced to coincidences of this type: delta RS equals delta P minus R Q minus S. So that's at C equals CPQ. So if you add to that the usual identity delta RS equals delta minus R minus S, so this one is valid for any central charge. Well, you can generate essentially all the identities of degenerate dimensions that occur at this particular central charge. Yes?
P and Q should also be positive integers, right? Not only
integers. Well, so you're asking why P and Q are not positive integers. And for the moment, they are not yet positive, because all I have assumed is that you have doubly degenerate representations, and that can also occur if P and Q are negative, if one of them is negative. So I will soon start assuming they are positive in order to really get minimal models. So actually, why do I assume they are positive? Well, because here, it's really heuristic now. This identity of conformal dimension suggests that there is a nice class of doubly degenerate representations. So the doubly degenerate representations with R between 1 and P minus 1, and S between 1 and Q minus 1. So let me call this set of doubly degenerate representations the Katz table. So for the moment, it's some nice set of doubly degenerate representations. But this set, in order for this set to be not empty, I need P and Q to be positive and even greater than 2. And in this case, I could be tempted to write some spectrum, SPQ, as just the sum of the representations in the Katz table from R equals 1 to P minus 1. S equals 1 to Q minus 1, RS times R bar RS. Yes. So I will soon stop for a break, but let me comment on this spectrum. Well, first, before commenting, let me correct this spectrum, because actually that's wrong. Due to this relation, actually I have an identity of the type RRS equals R P minus R Q minus S. Well, after all, I must have such an identity if the representation is to be doubly generate. But it means that I have some symmetry in this Katz table. So by doing all this sum, I'm overcounting each representation. I'm counting each representation twice. So I have to put a factor 1/2 to correct that. And therefore, I obtain a nonsatz for the spectrum of a minimal model. Well, I still have to show that it is a minimal model, and first of all, that it obeys the axiom of closure on diffusion. But that we can do after the break. So, questions? Well, yeah, let's have the break then.